So like I said, we're part of Knife Moves. Sorry if I'm yelling. I can't really. I think the coffee's kicking in. We're part of Knife Moves. If you're not familiar, we are a kind of a local organization, kind of media group that deals with everything from animation to illustration to video, film, audio, graphic design, and we're kind of we're trying to bring everybody together as a community. So if you're not familiar with us, I recommend going to our website, which is www.nicemove-moves.com, and then you can also go to our Facebook and our LinkedIn page. We got plenty of information there, and that'll also take you to the website as well. So I want to say a quick thank you to MCAD, everybody here. Totally appreciate all the effort and help into this. It means a lot. And the AV guys, thanks for the help as well. Hi. And just really quick, I also wanted to say, if you got a cell phone, just make sure it's on silent or vibrate. We just don't want those things going off while, you know, Mike's doing his thing, freaking out. With that, I would like to give a quick introduction to Mike. He is the executive producer and the co-creator of Danger and Eggs, which is a new animated series being streamed on Amazon. So if you haven't seen it, I highly recommend check it out. So ladies and gentlemen, with that, Mike Owens.
I did it again. Sorry. Hi, everybody. All right, so Danger and Eggs. I was asked to describe it, but I think I'm going to do it via the opening sequence because it does the best job of it.
A kid, an egg, a park, they do stuff, but there's more to it than that. It's kind of hard to explain, sort of like just
butterflies.
Kind of sort of just, you know,
huh?
It's kind of hard to explain. It's called Danger and Eggs.
All right. That's it. Good night, everybody. All right, let me PowerPoint it up here. I can do it, you guys. Yay, all right. Danger and Eggs. I'm going to try to talk to you. There's a lot to talk about. It's been a long journey since 2003 to where I currently am with this show and with these characters. So I'm going to kind of just take you a step back, but we're going to start with the present. So Danger and Eggs just came out, 26 episodes on Amazon Prime. We had a pretty awesome voice cast for guest voices on top of our lead characters, A.D. Bryant from Saturday Night Live, and Eric Noble, who's a local improv actor at Huge Theater, who is no one else in the world could play Philip but Eric. So I'm happy he was Amazon won all the way through. So it's currently out. Watch it, rate it, tell your friends. Just came back from Comic-Con. I'm kind of at this peak of the whole thing, so I'm bringing you where I'm currently at. There's me in the corner, kind of freaked out by the whole thing. That is doing the panel, where Chris Hardwick is the moderator. Eric and A.D. on Entertainment Weekly interviews, a guy whose job it was to cart us through Comic-Con's madness, and the crowd at the panel holding up these. Everyone who showed up to the panel got a production drawing from the show. So that was my point of view from the panel. And so this is sort of the, I won't make you read it, well, it looks bad on, the intro did better. This is sort of the current, how we talk about it, the PR that we put out about the show. But it's about the endless adventures of a fearless, tear-held girl named Dee Dee Danger and her ever-cautious best friend, a giant talking egg. You can read the rest. Dee Dee comes from a long line of daredevils. Philip is super paranoid, lives in a Godzilla-sized chicken that once destroyed the city. So he's very nervous, very fragile, very anxious. But they are best friends, and they get along through the buddy system of you look out for me, and I look out for you, which ended up being sort of the heart of the show Eric sort of brought to the table. But it really becomes this odd opposite couple, best friends that somehow work and became a show. And people seem to be liking it so far. So that's where I'm currently at with this show. That's the present, that's the hoopla, that's the shiny bits. So now I'm going to take you all the way back to where it began for me, which was the idea. So So the beginning of Philip, it all started with Philip. And this is the first drawing ever of Philip. So that is the first time. And he's been in my head for a while, as people that know me well will tell you. But 2003 is when I first put it down on paper. The essence of Philip is definitely there, the liver and the chicken, the cautiousness. Living out of a chicken's butt is the greatest joke ever. I'll talk about how Amazon tried to fight us on that. But he was still like regular egg sized. So I had this character, I had just moved to Minnesota. I was doing some freelance from stuff in Chicago, but for the most part kind of unemployed. So I had time to think about this stuff. I was really just exploring this character and, you know, sort of his personality and his, how he reacts to things, how he says things, you know, like that became, that was the thing that stuck through up until the show now, is just the way he phrases stuff, and Eric just really, he just brings so much even more to that. So it was just this lingering character. So he was much more breakfast-based. He was hanging out with bacon and English muffins. And yes, the bacon's name was Kevin. I'm sorry for that. But exploring this character, something about this character just felt right. I started doing a storyboard of him, he's living inside this giant chicken, seeing all of the disaster and horrible things outside of this safe, cushiony, you know, pink fleshy womb that he lives in. He's like a guy who's like never left his mom's basement, right? But it's because he's terrified of everything. That's what I liked about it. I was at the time, one, I was a kid who was afraid of everything. I was afraid of water and bees and dirt and sticks, and the ocean would touch my ankles and I would scream like someone was peeling my flesh off. So I was thinking about that at the same time when the color-coded threat level thing came out. We're like, it's orange, everybody shit your pants. Those two things sort of met in the middle and really were feeding on Philip. I just kept refining what he looked like. He looks a little different now, but his rubber gloves were there. His really nice shoes were there, all that stuff. So just trying to figure him out. You know, I was a trained animator, a hand-drawn animator for years. Worked on like Animaniacs and every Lucky Charms Trix Rabbit commercial and stuff like that. So being a character animator sort of where my head was at, not a show creator, but this character just was fun from the get-go. I liked thinking about his knee pads and how those worked and how his face was, you know, this flexible face that he could have that can just, you know, it's just on a surface and it can just be, you can do anything. It's the greatest cartoon. That's why SpongeBob is so good, because he's a funny shape doing funny stuff, and I'm telling you, that's the secret. So this is where I left off, and that was the poem I wrote about Philip. Everyone please read. So that was, again, still in 2003. That's kind of where I just had this character just living, you know, trying to figure out what to do with it. Then I had to move on, get a job and all that sort of thing, but you know, Philip was always in the back of my head. I worked with people at Ghost Production to try to make him in 3D animation so that I could learn Maya. It broke me. I didn't learn how to do it. I had to get money, so I started looking for work. So that takes us sort of the step two of collaboration of a character. So this nugget of an idea, this character that came out pretty strong, pretty clear from the get-go, and was from the get-go really fun. Apologize for the pun. Everyone catch it yet? All right. That's for you, Mindy. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of the collaborating with other people that took Philip to the next stage of his existence. So I got a job as animation director at Puny Entertainment, which I'm sure a lot of you guys are familiar with in town. Puny was based in Minneapolis for a long time. Chaddy Potoski and Vincent Stahl are the owners. puny SenseNet is now out in LA, but they did have dual offices for a while. But early on at puny, when I was there, they had this idea of making a short film by working with improv actors. And that's who you see up here is Hannah Coleman, Michael Ritchie, and Eric Noble, the voice of Philip, are in an improv group called Splendid Things. So they came in, and everyone at the studio pitched an idea, like a one-page pitch of like any show you kind of want to get, you want to explore, what do you want to try? So I of course brought Philip to it. We had talked about how to present it. I beefed up what I had from what I showed you, but basically we just covered a wall with single-page pitches for Splendid Things to come in and review and look at. And they all gravitated towards Philip, which was great, because now that I was at a place, there's going to be a small budget to actually make a short film of this character, something that I wasn't able to do on my own. And so to collaborate with all these people, with the whole crew at Puny, Will Shepard, who was a producer there, worked on, what is that Squiggle Vision show? Dr. Katz, very funny guy. He helped develop a lot of the story. But what we did was we had Hannah, Michael, and Eric come into a sound booth. We talked about the idea about what the show could be, but they basically improvised in a sound booth, and we made a story out of that. We cut audio. We had a broad outline, but we just let them run with it. Michael and Hannah can do 1,000 different voices, and we just let Eric the first time Eric spoke in Philip's voice, as Philip, it couldn't have matched more perfectly in my head. So that was very exciting, because now it's me in my basement not doing anything except for drawing eggs. Now someone else was reacting to this character and it was becoming something else because of Eric and these other collaborators. So one of the big changes was as simple as his size. He went from being literal egg size to being kind of like tall, awkward sports mascot size. And then this idea that, so the chicken, of course, had to be, had to match, right, size. She couldn't be smaller. It would be a horrible scene. So just this idea of giant egg living in giant Godzilla-sized chicken that essentially trampled its way into the city. And so behind the chicken is a path of destruction and mayhem and blood and guts of all the people she crushed. And so Philip, coming out of the back of the chicken, hits what he sees as the world, is this destroyed world. And he sort of, he's afraid of the world. He kind of feels obligated because it was his mother's fault for crushing all of these people. So he's, he's been inside protecting himself, becoming a master of first aid, learning every rule and regulation that you could. But he finally had to step out into the world and help. His name is Philip, and he's here to help. That's sort of his calling card, right? Like, he doesn't want to, but he'll do it. He's terrified, but he'll definitely do it. So that let me start thinking about Philip again, evolving him, pushing his character, what I can do with his face, just really starting to understand him, simplify him. This is where his jumpsuit came in, which I liked. Still has the knee pads, still always carries his first aid kit. None of that stuff changed. And then from that improv, we sort of was working with Mitch, who was a designer at Puny. I believe he went here, where he sort of got Philip to closest to what we see now. And then this giant hunter who was hunting the giant chicken because all these other giant animals got out. For some reason, in the improv, this sad, dramatic little German girl who didn't speak English, became characters. So Philip felt like that was like the person he would come to protect. And she's speaking German. He's like, I think your mouth is broken. And so it was like it was something for him to attach to. Because he wasn't really good at helping. He can do it when it comes down to it, but he's so paranoid, afraid, full of anxiety all the time. So I don't know anything about that. So these are some stills from the short. I didn't bring the whole short, but I'll show you a little clip of it. This is inside the chicken. the soft, warm, protective. And he plays the cello for it keeps him calm. It's his safe place. And he's got a Band-Aid on his head. Got a small crack there, which is sort of, you know, way back story of that's what made him paranoid, how fragile he is, how he can be broken at any minute, is why he started protecting himself. That is the back door. from the inside, and so, you know, he's hearing screams of terror and destruction outside, and he's compelled, I have to go outside and help. There's people impaled with stop signs, but this guy's freaking out because there's a bee flying around him, and that's what Philip focuses on, because he can handle that. And his advice is, like, there's a bee, and he's like, run, wait, no, don't do that. So he's, you know, he has trouble keeping it together. I'm going to show you just a little sample reel of that. Apologize for having to jump out here, but it's all good. Where is my big full screen? Whoops. Sorry.
Okay, everyone, please remain calm. I have been trained by myself in the arts of first aid, and I'm available to provide assistance.
Up for your lives!
Clear a path! There is a child in peril. I am certain I will eventually know what to do.
There's a bee flying around my shirt.
Hit it, and then run. Wait! That is the opposite of what you're supposed to do. My name is Philip, and I'm here to help.
We can dance.
So that was a taste of the short. Let's go back to this. All right. So made the short. Ended up being like maybe 2-3 minutes after all that improvising and developing that character a little bit further. Got into a couple festivals. I just sent them out on my own. We ran out of money in production, so I just fitted the bill for some of these festivals. There's a couple more. But it was back in 2010 again. So, again, the idea started in 2003, and it's 2010 that it's actually becoming a thing. So get it out in festivals. Got some good responses. Won awards somewhere. I don't know, but it's it's one of the people seem to like attach to the character. They really like the character. Not sure what to do with it beyond that. So then it was, you know, we felt like this character has something that it could keep going. So at PUNY, it was we were starting to get this idea of pitching shows and see what that was all about. This was the first original thing that we really created, got out there in the world. So we decided, hey, let's pitch it. Someone's going to want this thing because Philip is awesome. And that takes us to step three. lots of rejection, unfortunately. People loved Philip. People loved the idea of Philip. Could Philip be a show? No one was sold or convinced on that idea yet. We toured it, tweaked it, moved it around, tried different things. It wasn't quite weird enough for some networks. It was too weird for others. I mean, the short, which we don't show here, like scene one is like the chicken stepping on a bus and it bursts into flames and people scream. So it's like not a kid's show. But I didn't really intend it to be a kid's show, to be honest. I just, you know, destruction is funny when you have this character in the middle of it. So we tried and and it wasn't really working. But in the meantime, at PUNY, we were making a lot of cartoons. One of our first big gigs was doing all the 2D animation for Yo Gabba Gabba, and which led to doing all the animation for their live shows, to doing their websites, and that sort of got us an in for a lot of. We did shorts for Nickelodeon, for Disney, people that were other comedy groups, other like improv groups that were writing stuff. So This World of Bob down here was one. This is Katie Crown Pitch. This is a short for Disney. That was a short for Nickelodeon. That was for Mad TV. That's for the Aquabats. That's for the guys that make the Aquabats called Mew Teens. That was for Nickelodeon. That was an original content by Dave Hagen, who worked at Puny, called Ugly Mutt. That was a short I did for Yo Gabba Gabba for their in-between interstitials. So we were really getting good at making stuff and trying to just develop other pitches, and hopefully something would stick. But in the meantime, we were just sort of honing our craft and learning how this stuff worked, learning to be better storytellers. How to get Philip past this barrier was Dee Dee, who is the opposite of safety, which is exactly how I thought about it. I think we had pitched it to Cartoon Network? I forget. No, it was Nickelodeon. Whatever head of development, we showed it to him. They're like, his advice was, I think you could sell it if your character had a buddy, if your character had someone to sort of go on these adventures with, because Philip alone is too much, and we're not sure if it's going to sustain. The first consensus was, let's have a girl character, because there's never girl lead characters in cartoons, and then let's make her the opposite of Philip, and see where that takes us. So I just sort of went down this rabbit hole of what's the opposite of Philip. She comes from this, like, her family is like this lineage of Evel Knievel, daredevil stunt people. You know, grandparents met riding around that big cage that ride, you have motorcycles go in, like that's how they fell in love and stuff like that. Not that you'll see any of this in the show, but it's, you know, this is where I took my head, was back to like four generations before Dee Dee. And the kind of character I wanted her to be, we of course didn't want a princess character, and we didn't want, you know, a nerd character. She's a little bit, you know, Liz Lemon was sort of like that little awkwardness thrown into it, but still badass like Ripley. So it was like, you know, where do you find all, we find that mix of her to be the complete opposite of what Philip is. So a lot of exploratory sketching of how old she is, you know, what does she look like, how dangerous is she? Because, you know, Philip is like 6'2", and like, you know, getting even like graphically size relationship, or like, why is this adult hanging out with a 4-year-old and all that kind of stuff. So it was just playing, and, you know, this is how I think through all of my problems and story problems. Not much of like a writer. This is how I write until it starts to feel right. You know, and writing dialogue even, at one point I thought she calls him Mr. Egg and that would get past it. But just like, how do these people talk? How do they interact? And that led to, let me step back and start thinking about her dad. And, you know, this idea of him being constantly broken is sort of foreshadowing for Dee Dee of what's gonna happen. Because they're daredevils, but they're reckless. They leap before they, you know, they look, and they're just in it for the thrill and the next big thing. But they all end up broken because they don't think. So having Philip there to sort of spot her and, you know, put band-aids on her and all that kind of stuff, that then started to mesh. It started to make sense. And he eventually didn't talk. We thought that would be really funny if his neck brace was so high that he couldn't talk, so that he can't stop Dee Dee from doing anything. But Philip could try his best. And if she's going to do it and he's going to go along with her, he's going to make sure she's safe, and she's going to make sure he sees life beyond the chicken butt. So got there. So back to Dee Dee. Still couldn't figure out her age or look. this was a really repulsively funny one to me. Just trying to figure out, this is my favorite. Trying to figure out what her relationship would be with her dad. She was a little more teenager-ish, playing around with that age bracket. It was starting to set for me. So it was sort of like finding these designs. I was always drawing her in the suit ready to go, Evel Knievel suit. And it was like, yeah, a little too old. Let's make her a little bit younger. She started getting progressively younger and trying different things. And this is where it really started to, I mean, if you know the show, this is pretty close to what Dee Dee ended up being. Still maybe like 3 years too old. But the essence of her started to finally click, and then it became like I became a fashion designer. Like I wanted her to be, I wanted her to be badass, but I wanted her to be kind of cool, but you know, sort of have her own thing. And so just trying color combinations, trying, you know, there's consistent things like she's always got persistent Band-Aid on her knee. You know, there's things like little weird things like that just sort of stuck. Her like graphically sharp pointy hair to Philip's round shape is like not an accident. Like it's just a graphic contrast between the two. But like in this t-shirt became her sort of tunic thing that she wears. So that was, you know, Philip came sort of easy. Dee Dee was work. And there is now that I was collaborating, there's consensus involved and there's all this thing. So I just shut myself out to my desk and just went into the backstory, came out with Dee Dee. So that started to feel right to everybody. So now it was time to revamp the pitch, which takes us to step four, the pitch that finally worked after all those failures. So we had this one ready. And if any of you have tried to put together a pitch or have seen pitches for shows, a lot of times there's so much information and you don't know anything about the character unless you read six paragraphs, and that'll never work because, you know, an executive's going to have a stack of, you know, 100 things to look at. They're not going to take the time. If you can't grab them right away, you might miss your chance. If they've, you know, got a little indigestion and don't feel like reading, they're going to pass it up. So what we found was, and I'm going to give you a brief, I took out some of the pages, but I just wanted to give you a sense of what the pitch looked like. This is what Amazon saw, and this is what hooked them, and you'll see how simple it is. Like, that's the information we gave them for that page. And it became about talking about it, like being the storyteller in the room of the characters versus like giving them a giant paragraph about everything about, I just told you that backstory stuff. No one cares about that stuff at this stage, at the pitch stage. Like if they can see this dynamic, they can see these cool characters, they can see bright, shiny colors. It sounds like I'm degrading it, but I'm not. It's advertising, it's billboard. It's like, you know, they're seeing 1,000 things, so get their attention. So this was how we described Philip. And then, you know, I had this, all these things, the way he talks written, I decided to keep that in there because that's such a key part. And of course, reading it, you can't hear it yet. We showed him that sizzle reel as well. But to me, just his phrasing says so much about the character that I felt it was key to put that in there. Dee Dee, has asthma. So she has this one weakness. She wants to do anything, everything, jump off of buildings, hang glide, but she can break at any moment. So Philip's really got to watch her. So just her having a weakness instead of just being this, you know, bulletproof superstar made her interesting, made her vulnerable, made you cheer for her. There's Roy, perpetually injured. Becky, could have showed the giant chicken, but just showing the legs said so much more. And it's super simple, straight to the point. And if they're like, what's that all about? Then you can start telling the story about the giant chicken because they just saw this these giant legs. And I have Wendy to thank for Becky, the name Becky, because it's Becky, like a chicken. So, and the pitch had a little bit about the world. So this takes, in our minds, we didn't talk too much to Amazon about the destructed world, but we didn't show them much, but this is the backstory. The city has recovered after she trampled through and destroyed the city. They built things around her, giant footsteps that, you know, killed people. But they built around her and sort of kept her fat and happy and fed, and she just sort of roosted there. She could leave at any moment, but for now, everything's cool. Phillip's got her blocked off with some safety cones. Things should be good. She's pretty gargantuan there. We adjusted the size, but this is where our world of our show is going to take place. And that's what worked. That's what, when Amazon saw that, Aaron, our executive at Amazon, that made sense to people. So we finally, from 2003 all the way up to, this was 2014 maybe, it finally, like someone said, sure, we'll try that. So we got a green light to do something with this. So like, oh great, now we have to actually do it. And, you know, we've done these shorts before, but that they were sort of, they weren't our original thing, or they had, you know, Nickelodeon was paying for it. But fortunately, what happened with Amazon, it happened in steps, excuse me, went to step five, which was the option deal. And if you don't know what that is, it's basically the content, this idea, this show is taken off the market, and you can't pitch it or show it to anybody else because they're going to try it on for size. So if you ever get an option deal, it's a good thing. It sounds like, you know, oh, I can't show it to anyone else, but just take it because someone's invested and interested enough. So what did we have to do? You have an option deal. What they needed us to do was to write a script, do some visual development, more character development, and a storyboard. And they gave us, you know, I don't know what the budget was. It wasn't huge, but it was enough to pay us to make a storyboard and convince them that this could be a show. And that's as much as they were paying for. That's as much as they were interested in doing. Great. So we have to prove ourselves on that. So I went back into thinking about, you know, we got this interesting contrast in characters visually, graphically. You know, their basic backstories are different. Their, you know, basic outlook on the world is different. But then why do they work? So it was like we really, well, between writing and drawing and developing these characters is figuring out and convincing everyone that, like, these opposites are going to be great together. And we didn't really know. We had a voice for Philip. Philip was clear. He was easy. Like, I could do Philip. I can animate and draw and think about Philip all day and night. At the time, Dee Dee, no one really... What does she sound like? What, you know, because she could become off as really obnoxious and really like, I'm going all the time, and just nobody wants that. It gets exhausting. So it's thinking about the dynamic between the two, and as simple as those two words is how they approach everything. She's ready to go. He's like, hold on a second. And then it started to like, okay, I'm starting to get it. And then so it was, you know, script, story, outline, drawing, like this developing to convince. And as the script was developed, I was able to start having scenes and things to draw in context to really start understanding their dynamic visually, graphically, and emotionally. What was their friendship all about? What's going to be fun to see them on screen doing? And then, as you know, once we really started getting the script and the outline locked down, now I had this world. We had this story. It's called The Tube of Pain, which is this giant abandoned water slide that was left in the park, and for some reason, no one noticed it until today. But then it was like, so great. Now we have a thing to throw these characters into. How do they react differently? How do they react together to this? You know, of course, for Dee Dee, this is the most greatest thing in the world. This is Philip's nightmare. But he can't let her go in there alone. So how do we get in there? How do we force that to happen? What do we do once they're in there? How much danger are they really in? So there's, you know, exploring how ridiculous this slide really is, and how they said it looked like pee, so I changed that. But it does? All right. But, you know, this idea of how perilous this whole thing is, and that was really fun, like, because, you know, like, this is the meat and the fun of making a cartoon, right, is this kind of stuff, and, like, I'm going to throw a fragile egg and, like, a 10-year-old girl inside of this thing, and they have to not die. And it has to be funny. You know, that was our challenge. So it became a story sketching at that point. These were moments in the actual story where there's like a It's a Small World kind of place in there, which Philip is great because it moves really slow, there's seat belts, you know, there's flowers singing at you, it's the greatest. But, you know, there's getting flesh down the pipe at the beginning, which is terrifying for one, the greatest thing in the world for another. This thing is falling apart, it's rickety, it's broken. There's been bats and snakes and squirrels and all these animals living in it that have knotted together in sort of a rat king monster that they're going to have to face. So that's sort of like the big beast that they're going to, you know. So like it was, they're in this sort of basically a park. It's public green space is where most of the series and the stories take place. But how far can we push weirdness not just for the sake of weirdness, but in context of story. So Dee Dee's like, I have to ride this thing. Philip's like, I don't think that's a good idea, but I'll be there. And like, holy shit, there's a giant monster made of snakes and rats. And then there's an extra added element, because again, remember, I had to make it funny. There is Duncan, who is, this isn't the final design, but these are my favorites, so I showed these instead. Where he's been trapped inside this since he was 7. He never came out the other side. So he's just this man-child that's like, he's not really fat as much as he bloated with water, like when you're in a bathtub for too long. So he's kind of squishy. Yeah, he's waterlogged. So, and you know, he's got an A-team shirt on. So this is the other thing they come across. So like, you know, it's not only like that this water slide is going to fall apart. They have to face a monster and a ridiculous adult in his underpants. You know, again, just starting exploring how this, the top of the slide, they're ready to go in. Philip's got sort of his safety station set up, ready to go. He's going to monitor the whole thing. That's how he's decided he's going to deal with it. She's got to wear this safe suit of safe swimming. She's got to wear floaties and carry a fire extinguisher and everything she can with her. Like then he's okay with letting her go, because her dad, of course, can't stop her because he's muffled. So this sort of visual development on top of the storyboard that we're script, storyboard, visual development. This is what we were, in part of the option deal, we were convincing Amazon that this was a good idea to give us more money to make a show. So this is them climbing up the water slide, just how dangerous it is, how she's having a snack. He's, of course, terrified. They're high enough that they're, you know, getting high enough, higher than the birds. The scale to the Becky over there. So, you know, this is sort of the world we wanted to play in, and this is what we wanted to convince Amazon to let us do. So I think, we, you know, at this point, we really started like, all right, we get it. I think this is going to be fun. We know we can kind of, we're excited to see where this is going to go. So we really convinced them on this level. So all of those doodles turning into this stuff is sort of what it led to for me. And then we did the storyboard. I could show, where am I on time? Does anyone know? We're good? What does that mean? Like I have 5 minutes or a half? I have 23 minutes. Okay. I can maybe show, I'll show a couple of the boards. I just have to close around this. I've sort of lost track of where I am, what slide I'm on. Oh, I'm at 63. That's more than halfway. We're good. All right, so I'll just sort of quickly go, but this is what we delivered. Philip coming out. Philip, I'm here to help. No one's really needs his help. There's a woman feeding pigeons and a guy stretching to go jogging and like a squirrel running around. So he's ready to help, but no one really needs it because things have calmed down since the destruction days. But he's still gonna go out and do his thing. He's gonna put up some traffic cones. He's backing up like a truck. Beep, beep. Is he setting down his? he's very official about, you know, his safety, and he's, you know, he takes it very seriously. He's hydrating joggers, checking their pulse. He's teaching squirrels to chew their food properly. And he is going to check this. He has to check all the benches for splinters. So he's got to temporarily remove the pigeon lady. And he, of course, has a back brace on because you don't want to strain yourself. So he throws down some orange cones. He lifts up the pigeon lady, gently sets her down. All the pigeons, of course, stay with her. And they afflux her. and then he's, you know, I think he puts gloves on top of his gloves or just snaps them. He's ready to de-splinter. You know, there you go. Bench, prepare for de-splintering. He pulls out his fingernail clippers. He's going to get that little clip. And then here comes Dee Dee screeching in on a scooter. Not like a Vespa scooter. It's like the kind you like you shop in Walmart. So it goes like half a mile an hour, but she's going reed as she comes in. Reed. And Philip's freaking out because he's going to bump into his cones. Oh, no. And he bumps a cone. She does a parkour flip, lands on one of the cones. She's excited to show him about her new skull cam, her new GoPro. You can monitor, you can watch it through this thing. We're going to do something awesome today. She's flipping around, and Philip's kind of uncomfortable. She's cartwheeling, flipping, doing backflips, ready to be awesome. Pops out of the tree. Let's do something great today, Philip. And he said his idea is to, of course, make safety videos. So let's document the world's safest park, because he's done such a good job that there's nothing dangerous anymore. That's what we're setting up here. So through the monitor, we see there's a lifeguard at the duck pond. There's sandbags and barriers around the slide. There's, you know, multiple crossing things, security cameras. That squirrel's teaching. He's sharing the knowledge and teaching him how to. Okay, good. Philip's like, yes, we'll do that as long as we don't go anywhere near that really dangerous thing. And she, of course, Dee Dee gets excited, and that's where, like, this giant thing has been there the whole time, of tube of pain. And then she finds out, oh, they're going to be knocking that down tomorrow, which is ridiculous to her, so we've got to ride it. It's going to go away. Are you kidding me? We have to do it today. And he doesn't think it's a good idea, because the last child that went in there never came out, and there's the photo of Duncan. And, you know, it was a terrible, Philip often, like, he's very shy, like, watch it, and then he'll get very introspective. It's a terrible day for park safety. It hurt him deeply that someone would have got lost and he wasn't there to help. So he begins sort of a soliloquy for Duncan through the darkness, and Dee Dee's like, already, we're doing it. I don't care what you say. It's my dream to do it. And he's like, I know it's not the safest thing. It's the least safest thing. But friends should support each other. She gives him that smile. And he's like, all right, good support keeps things from falling apart. And he has an idea. Okay, there's more of it, but I want to move on. But that's sort of that's our intro to the thing. And that's what we got to Amazon. So all those, that visual development that I showed you, the script and a storyboard. And then we sent it to Amazon, and the next step was to wait. Also a Philip catchphrase, because Dee Dee's always running off. So we waited to go through their layers of executives and everyone to look at it. And decide whether they wanted to spend some money on it, because Amazon has, if you don't know, they have their pilot season once a year, where they'll try out different pilots for things, and people can watch, rate, review, and that determines what goes forward. Not everything will. Could be one, could be all of them. They're good enough. It's not really a contest as much as it is a trial thing. So it was sort of a new outlet that, like, not going to a network, you know, being streaming video, the rules were a little bit different, so no one else would say, like, do us a pilot, and then we'll see. They were sort of like, it's either going to work or it's not. So this was, even though we were waiting and we weren't sure, this was a great place to be in. So after much waiting, they're like, great, we want you to be one of our pilots for our pilot season. Thank you. So that's awesome. So all of that work and all that thought since 2003 to now, and all that collaborating, we're ready to go. We're going to make this pilot. At the time, Puny had changed. Puny was in LA. I had an office in LA, office here, which actually worked to the benefit, because being in LA, you get to, like, get these meetings and get the right place, right time. Because I don't understand. I wish I could give you a secret about how successful pitches work as far as, like, when and, like, guaranteed. But you see how many years we were already working on it. And it was being at the right place, the right time, but being prepared, all that stuff. Because, some of the ones where I talked about being failures, where it didn't work or they passed up on something, it's simply because the executive who loved it got a different job and a different executive came in and didn't want their projects. So, like, it's, you know, you just have to be persistent, be prepared, and expect to fail a lot. And if the idea is good enough, it'll stay there. And, you know, I just feel like Philip was unsinkable. It was great. So now they're doing a pilot. There's more stuff to do. There's rewrites. They're like, sure, it's good, but now can you change 2/3 of it? I'm not kidding. We we changed Act 1 and Act 3. After all that work, they're like, yeah, we love it, but can you change 70% of it? Sure. Of course we can. You're writing the checks. And we had to, so Puny was changing. No longer a giant team. It was more of a project-based, higher-up-as-you-go sort of thing. There was only a couple core people. I was there. Mark was there as an editor. Evan, who was the art director on the on Danger and Eggs, was there. But we, and Chatty was in L.A., and Vincent was here. We're like, oh, we have to make a pilot. Great. We should probably put a team together. And so we did, but still not a very big team. It was, I did the boards. We had an editor. We had a producer come in to keep these organized. I don't know if Drew is here. Drew, are you here? I don't know. Drew, who worked on the show, was designing props for us. I was designing characters. Evan was doing backgrounds. Because what we had voices in place. We did, we had temp voices to start with. We had Eric, of course. We didn't have AD yet, so we had to find who's going to be Dee Dee. Working with a place like Amazon, it's sort of like, who do you want? And we're like, ooh, really? So it was like, I want Aubrey Plaza, or I want, you know, you could say that stuff, and then it becomes like, who's available, who's interested, whatever. But, you know, you just had this access that we didn't have before. Philip was locked down, so we auditioned people. AD Bryant was great. So we had that lockdown. And then, you know, we had to just do this whole production. And the other thing is we were, you know, because there was only six or eight of us doing this pilot, the animation itself was going to get done at Seiram Animation in South Korea, who does Adventure Time and Simpsons and Futurama. They're the overseas production company there. Because again, through Amazon, you could like get that kind of hookup, which is sweet. Because, you know, we just weren't staffed to do a pilot. You know, 11-minute pilot takes a lot. And the amount of time we had, it just let's go with what works. So this production studio is going to be lined up. So we had to have our shit together up front of a really tight animatic, all of our designs figured out. But again, we had to get a musician, we had to get a composer, we had to get all these pieces into place. Shadi came back from LA, you know, we were, you know, in this office, there was no other projects going on in the studio, only this. So I went back to storyboarding. I did it on paper for a while, which was really fun because we just had the wall up, you know, that you see in every behind the scenes. We decided we'd live that fantasy. But it helped talk through. I mean, that's why they do that, right? It's easy to talk through the problems and solve some things. So there's a lot of rewrites, reboarding, notes. This is what most of my life looks like. But then, you know, then the fun stuff starts to happen where I finally lock down these characters and I have to provide production artwork of model sheets and turnarounds and expression sheets. Finally really lock down who Dee Dee looked like, how they looked together, because other people were going to draw this. Like, I was just doing the board. So we had to do all this pre-production work. So this is the most solid this world and these characters have ever been. Philip's mouth shapes, because, you know, if TV animation, you sort of have this limitation of, you know, it's for efficiency, you have a certain amount of mouth shapes, and this is how we do the, if you're not familiar with TV animation, where you have, you know, break the phonetic breakdowns, and you just assign one of these mouths to it. Like, that was my job, too, was listen to the soundtrack, and I would say this mouth, and this mouth, and this mouth, and this mouth, for him to say butterflies. We had to, there's what Duncan finally looked like, by the way. color for the painters, for the ink and paint, you know, we had to figure, like, this is the kind of work we did up front, all this pre-production work, because we weren't going to be the animation production, but we were going to be the storytellers, we were going to be there for the voice recording, we were going to design everything, we were going to prepare it for this other studio to take it and make it. They're not going to, like, embellish it, they're going to do what we give them, so if we're not exact, so every prop had to be figured out, if there's a thing of soda, if there's a pigeon, if there's some goop, gum on the floor. We had to design it. We had to provide it. We had to give a number for it so that we could reference it. We had to know how big the characters look, size to everybody, so that the animators weren't drawing things all out of proportion and drawing, you know, make sure the scale worked for everything. Even down to the logo, like this is a small taste of how many logos I had to do for Amazon to go, and like, what difference does it make? But it makes a difference. And Dave Hagen, our designer who did that Ugly Mutt, he did his own like 25 versions of it as well. So like all these things had to be figured out to brand it, make it real, to make it ready for production. And we finally did it. We made this pilot. It was, we got through all the notes, through all the versions of boards and more notes, more fights, a little bit of crying. We got everything prepared for Seiram in South Korea. They brought it back. I had the composer do the soundtrack, come up with sort of themes, not even for the title, but also for like themes for Philip when he's happy, when he's worried, Didi when she's excited. Really like laying the groundwork for what this show could be, because we have one shot at this for the pilot to like convince you of this, drop you into this world, know a relationship, prove to you that it's going to be fun, funny, interesting, and it can go more further than just this tube of pain. But we did it. We got it to the point. And I want to show you real quick the a bit of the final animation that and against the animatic to show you how in sync they had to be. Like, it wasn't sort of like, I'm going to doodle some boards and hope they make it. We had to do it. So this is from the pilot. This is after the rewrites. So it's the beginning I just showed you, but not at all.
Knock, knock. Philip!
Didi, huh? Is it camera day?
It's camera day.
I'm feeling excitement in my belly. Wait, no. Stuck in my mom.
Check it, the Frontal School Cam 2000, made for extreme sports. Did you pack any cool obstacle-making stuff?
A lot. I call this bag miscellaneous.
Yes. Picture this, Didi's and Phillip's, because you're gonna help me make it, extreme obstacle run.
Shot in high definition.
Let's make it. First, we gotta clear Lady Bench.
On it. Ma'am, please remain calm. As today's park activity expert, I'm relocating you.
I'm flying. I'm landing.
Okay, I'll jump this bench. Then I'll sprint across the park. Then I'll hurdle some dogs. How high can we stack dogs?
Without a permit? 7.
Great. Then I'm sliding through squirrels. Climb that construction worker. Why are there so many construction workers today? After that, I'll take one bite of ice cream. Hold still, 300 seconds. Then, Philip, I'm gonna slide under your legs and you'll grab my hands and throw me through a giant ring of fire and then splash into this fountain. Philip?
Arm strain is no laughing matter.
Philip, did you find a huge ring of fire? Because it goes here.
Not yet, but I did bring a fire extinguisher in case a ring of fire was on location.
Aw. There's never flaming stuff. I'll say it again. This park just isn't dangerous enough. Whoa!
Didi, are you okay? Do you remember the fourth grade?
Yeah. Why all the construction machines? Gasp! Are they helping us build our obstacle run?
Nope. They're going to tear down that monstrosity tomorrow.
The tube of pain! What? They can't demolish that! Aw. I promised my father that one day I'd stunt ride it. I should ask him. Father, can I conquer the most dangerous abandoned water slide in the world? Today's my last chance. Yay! Let's go now!
So there's that. So that was a bit of the pilot. I'm sorry, I wish I had the music version of it, because Andy Bean, who did the music for this, did the music for Wander Over Yonder, if any of you guys know that show. He's awesome. He was, he was great to work with. He did a really wonderful job for this show. So I wish you would have heard it, but we'll hear it later. So we made the pilot. We went through all the sweat and tears of making this. The next step was to wait again. And we did. We waited. So they put it out on Amazon. It's pilot season. And they're like, thanks, guys. We'll let you know. And that was 2015, right? 15? Yeah. Again, started in 2003. So we had to watch this happen. Like just watching those that bar rise and fall. Because, with Amazon Prime and their shows and their pilot seasons, they rate, you know, they collect the data, who's clicking, who's watching it part of the way, who's watching all the way through, who's watching it more than once, who's leaving comments. This is, you know, kind of the only information we had. Like, we just, like, gave everything we could to that, and it was up to the masses to decide, plus Amazon to decide if they wanted to keep going. But the data collected on streaming views played a huge role in it. Again, we were up against five other shows as well, all also watching the stars rise and fall and the reviews come in and not knowing anything. All good stuff. If our show didn't go, this one totally should have went, by the way. She's from Adventure Time. It was hilarious. So, you know, that was the real competition. We had the other ones. Just kidding. Kind of. So while we're waiting, competing with, you know, they could have picked all of them if they wanted to, if they were all that popular. So while we're waiting, we had a big premiere party at the Parkway Theater. Red carpety kind of thing, invited all of our friends, talked about the show, that we had our first cosplay, our friend's daughter dressed up like Dee Dee. You know, we just had a good old time. We had food, we had drinks. Some of you here might have been there. Just to sort of keep it alive and, like, because we worked very hard on it. And then we had friends and family put out fan art. Oh, there she is again. Just putting out fan art. Greg, you made that egg with me. Just to sort of, they would just put the, you know, share this on Facebook, you know, Instagram, what have you, just to sort of keep it alive and get, you know, people, like, at some points literally begging people to watch it. And, like, you know, because the views mattered, like, that was, that data mattered. They're only going to advertise so much. You know, they've already put their money in, so it's really us to, like, get behind our own show for the most part. And, you know, as people liked it, people were responding to it. It was getting good reviews. People were watching it multiple times. People were just setting it on loop at their home and watching when having it play when they weren't there. But some people, you know, which is fine. It's part of the game, I guess. But people were genuinely interested in it as well. It wasn't just cheating. Because we started, you know, I showed you the stars and we started getting some comments back like this. Which was, you know, this is what people are saying about something we just spent this much time on. And, you know, Amazon, of course, also sees that. And I really love this idea that, like, a character with anxiety, someone, like, feeling good about that. Because that was the thing. That was, like, the thing you couldn't convince people of, that a character with anxiety could sell a show. And without fail, it was, even at all the way up to Comic-Con recently, people were like, thank you so much for, like, having a character with anxiety and not be the butt of every joke. And, like, he's dealing with it. But, you know, so it was like, okay, anxiety is sort of a real thing for people. And, like, I certainly understand that. Where do you think this character came from? I mean, I'm all cool up here talking right now, but I'm sweating and just want to crawl back in this hole right now. But you know, this is the feedback we are getting, right? So it was looking good and feeling good, but, you know, we were still waiting. And it was winter and, you know, you're stuck inside. I'm not taking on any other jobs because if this happens, I got to be ready to go. So you're just, like, swimming in, like, success. I'm tired. I have doubts. Everyone hates it. Everyone loves it. Like, you just stew in your old madness for a while. And then they're like, all right, great. Do it 25 more times, everybody. And we're like, yay, shit. they want us to go to series. You know, it's awesome news. It's terrifying news. Because, you know, I just told you what it takes just to get to the pilot and all those years and all that work and all the, you know, what it takes to get, I need this. Like, I'm amazed that anything gets made or done after doing this, let me tell you. So many people have a decision and stuff, like the finger holes in all the pies. Everyone, you know, it's just everybody wants a piece of this. Everybody has their opinion. There are people whose job it is to give notes. But I digress. Let's do this 25 more times, everybody. Shadi goes back to LA. Puny's pretty much not really much in Minnesota as a studio anymore, in spirit and in, you know, but it was, the future was uncertain. So paying for a studio here wasn't really driving. So it was like, she's going back to LA. If we get this series, we'll see what happens. Pretty much. So we're going to do it. Now we've got all these things to do. lots of things to think about, because now we have to do 25 of these things, and it has to be good and has to be consistent. There's a real budget that they're going to watch every dime. There's a locked release date. There's no time, you know, there's no like, hey, we need another month. They're like, nope, too bad, you don't get another month. And we had to do this over between St. Paul, LA, South Korea, and New York, where 80 was, because she was filming Saturday Night Live, and she had to do voices from New York. We did Eric's voice from here. We were doing this writing and design in LA, and we were doing storyboards and animatic in St. Paul. We had to coordinate all of that and make 25 shows in a year or less. So yay, let's do that. So there was up to that build up point, there's definitely fun stuff where I got to really, you know, we showed you that pitch and I was talking about how like all that information, no one wants to see all that stuff. Now I get to do all that stuff. We get to do the production Bible and really just like spell it out of like, what is everything we can think of about this show? Because now it's a real thing. So now it's not just one thing about a character. These are of course individual pages. But all sorts of any kind of background information about the characters, because there's going to be so many people working on this show now. And we had 16 or 17 people here in St. Paul. There's like 20 people in LA, team of 150 in Sarum, and then they're all going to be working on this. So everyone had to be on the same page, plus a team of writers, like I don't know, 15 writers, whatever it was. It was our job again to get everyone on the same page, stylistically, thematically. Design-wise, humor-wise, messages that we wanted to get across, rules of the universe. So, you know, that's what we got to spend the first couple months doing this while our scripts are being written, ideas are being pitched, clock is ticking. You know, just the idea that animals, like, there's not going to be anthropomorphic talking animals. There are squirrels or squirrels in this world. Even though there's a giant talking egg with legs for some reason, these are our rules. Rules on how to even writing this stuff. And we had, you know, it was intentional to not have, you know, the stereotypical bully or the princess character or to, you know, and we wanted to be, wanted to have representation in this show where this is a world, we called it, speculative social something. Speculative social fiction, that's what it is, it's right there. Of just making a world where like, this is how it should be. Like there's people from all walks of life in this green space where everybody meets in a city, people from all walks of life. We weren't gonna like, you know, point it out. This is how it was going to be in our world. There's enough weirdness with Philip to worry about. Like we just wanted them to live in a world that we wanted to see. So the writers needed to know that. They also needed to know that, you know, there's the park, but our story went vertical as well. There's all these layers underneath of underground caverns. Because after the destruction of the city, this they built on top of it and things, and there's secret government layers, and there's subways, and there's Morlocks. But there's also stories that take place on the space station. There might be a meteor coming in, or a CEO at the top of a skyscraper at his helicopter pad. Like, so our story wasn't limited to the park. It also went this way, and we sort of figured it out at the spaces as we went. We had the fountain, we had Becky, we had where the Tube of Pain used to be, but it's a park you can explore, and it's a park from like a kid's point of view, where like you go into a park and it's a whole world in and of itself. So it's like a video game when you have a map and you only see the parts you've explored. That's how we thought about the show. So we're making this series, we, you know, on our end, we had a lot of fun stuff where this is what our world looked like, was coming up with story, drawing on post-it notes, figuring, you know, getting script notes, we would get the script, we would get radio play, which is just the recorded voices. Again, they're happening in here, New York, LA. We'd get that cut together, roughly edited together, to give us sort of performance cues to the performance of the characters. But our team here in St. Paul was doing this. We were coming up, we were being the story, the visual storytellers based on these scripts. Out in LA, they, as these scripts were coming in, they were designing new characters in a new world. Also writing more scripts, like we didn't have them all ready, and like, there's 25 scripts, go. It's like, here's three scripts, let's keep going. And we would just write them as they go. But you know, now we gotta start to add more characters to this world. And if you know, there's, it's, anyone can come in and out of this world in this park. Again, it's a central sort of green space. This is, you know, their friends, the people they're gonna interact with, they're gonna have these adventures with. To really sort of figure out the world as we went. We didn't, you know, the scripts really dictated how far this world was gonna go. But this is what it all comes down to, folks, the exciting world of schedules. This is why any of this stuff gets done, okay? This is just, those are all the episodes, those are all the milestones. We spent 4 or 5 months working on getting the schedule locked down. That's where a lot of effort and sweat went into, is how many people do we need to hire? How long is it gonna take? How long do you think you can get this done? How many reviews do you want? How many, it was great. So this is a very blown up version of the entire season. From, we had the pilot counted, so technically we only had to do 25, not 20, you know, 6. But that is the span, and we were doing 2 episodes at a time to get this done. There's a little blow up of that. So just to give you an idea of sort of how to get something like this done on this scale, assuming that the script is done on this date, and it had to be. That's sort of the way it rolled. Script, 1 week. They record it, they cut the radio play, and then we get our board team gets it here. We've got 4 weeks to do the board, and that includes reviews, notes, changes. And we're doing 2 of these at a time. We had 2 separate teams here. 2 directors, and they had their own set of, it was a lot to coordinate. And we had to do this very, as you saw from the example, the animatic to the animation, had to be very tight for Sairam to animate all these stuff. There's no room for guesswork. A lot of people on the crew here were new to this. There was a little ramp up period, but we did it. We did it well. And so drawing the sword, then animatic, we had to cut and edit it to the sound play and add some sound effects and get it to feel right and go through those reviews. Every week is a review and everyone's got something to say about it. But the deadlines don't change, and there's, guess what? 2 weeks have passed, next two stories are coming. So it's this endless barrage of make a cartoon. It's fun and full of sparkly dust. Honestly, that's like the trick, is like keeping your like cartoon making joy there while you have to do this kind of stuff, and now there's all these people involved, and you want everyone to be at their creative best. It's no joke, but there's lots of good jokes in the show. So here, I broke this down this morning, and it I didn't realize it until today. So takes about 38 weeks to finish 1 episode, from script to final color, sound effects, music, done. Okay? We did 25 11-minute episodes, doing 2 at a time. If we did these back to back, like finished one, do the next one, it would take 9 years to make this show. We had less than a year to do it. So by doing 2 episodes at a time, every 2 weeks, we'd start another two. We're able to do 25 in 64 weeks. And that's because of all those wonderful schedules I showed you before, and creative coordination and collaboration is pretty insane. Again, I don't know how things get made, but I guess this is how. It's different when you're in it, I think. Charts, facts and figures aside, this is where it's at. That picture turned out bad. I'm sorry, people in LA. But this is really, you know, this is the heart of it, everyone. You know, this is our crew here in St. Paul. There's the crew in LA. There's part of the crew in South Korea. Like, it takes that many people, and that's not even all of them. I didn't even get them all in there to make a show, something that starts out with, like, I'm thinking about my childhood and eggs in the basement. And now there's 400 people making a show about it. It's madness, but kind of awesome. We are pretty exhausted after that. This was the schedule we had to hit for everyone, and I just had to track them. So all of these post-it notes here at one time started over here. I had marked every time we had a review, every time we had to see it, we had to get all the notes done by a certain point. We just had to keep this train moving, and you know, I had good producers, I had a good team that really supported each other. I know they were doing great stuff in LA, and we were communicating through, we used Google Docs for everything, so they could put up a new design, we could give notes on it, we could put up our boards. So we made the cross-continent sort of thing work. But I can really only speak firsthand for my crew here, so I gave them an extra picture. Because they worked very hard, and it's to do something like that here is pretty unheard of. I think that's kind of the exciting thing, as Amazon was cool enough to let me lead a team here. And everyone was local. A lot of them MCAD grads, so MCAD. These are people in the Twin Cities that made this, that were part of my team, and that's exciting to me. It should be exciting to all of you, and it should be encouraging. I don't know if it'll ever happen again, whether this show or another, I don't know. Snowbait is now gone. We got a lot of money because of Snowbait, but so, you know, vote about that stuff. Not to get political or anything, but like, it's part of the reason we were able to do this, because we were able to shave like $400,000 off the budget because we were doing part of the production here. Whatever my, you know, heartbreaking story about, everyone's talented here, let's do it here. They're like, we'll save you $400,000. You're like, okay, and then they're into it. So like, that stuff matters. But we worked really hard. We did this show. We did 26 of them. Nice things are being said about it online. These are just a couple things I grabbed. Articles that have been written about it. I mean, you know, Amazon has their PR team that sort of, you know, pushes this stuff out and helps us get there. So all that stuff, we're still doing stuff on our own, but that stuff for the pilot where we were doing all of that, now we've got Amazon helping us do all that stuff because, you know, they've invested in it. And here are the current reviews that we're getting, which is pretty great. So, you know, this is what we're watching now. So now we wait until they see if they do want to go to season two or like, thank you, that was very nice. We'll see you. Don't know. They're a streaming channel. They don't have like a, you know, they can do whatever they want. They have space program. They can do what they want. We'll see. So far, so good. We've made it through all these other hurdles. So we started from that. This chicken egg thing that was in my head. To two best friends who are looking out for each other. You look out for me and I'll look out for you. That sort of, that held true for me. Like all the headaches that I told you about, and I've got more if you want to hear it. What this proved to me is you throw these characters anywhere and they work. And that was what we had to sell. And whatever else happens, their dynamic worked. I mean, the funny thing too is Eric and AD never met until Comic-Con, ever face to face, and it worked. But this is, you know, this buddy system, you look out for me and I look out for you. To me, that's what the show is about. That's why I think it's people are responding to it. As simple as that, and that's what matters to me. So there you go. There's the journey. I'll open it up to some questions.
Woo!
We want lights up, or is this all right? Or because I don't. Yes. The no, all we had online was the short that we made, that that more violent, fiery short. That's it. It was, we kept it. It wasn't like it didn't exist in any other. It wasn't a comic book. It wasn't its own world at all. It was just that that short film. Once it got picked up on Amazon, we had to get rid of all things online about it. Yeah. Yeah. That depends. If you're going to go straight, that's a good question and a hard question. If you're just going to go straight for the pitching, maybe keep it private if you just kind of want to sell it around that way. But the more, after going through this experience and, you know, this idea of collaborating and how much a thing goes out of your hands, and there's so many people making decisions, and how hard it is to like really like keep it grounded in what matters. I've been telling everybody, whether I'm teaching class or anything, is like, make a thing, get it out there. Because what I'm finding out now is, if you come with an audience, more likely to get picked up. So everything we do at Peony and everything that this has been weird and like not standard, honestly. So I don't know if I'm helping any of you, but. Really, I think it's so possible to get an audience now. I mean, you have to, you know, a big one, but I feel like you have an audience, it gets out there, someone sees it. When if someone buys it, your creative input and control is going to be a little tighter. Does that answer the question?
Yeah. All right. Can you talk a little about what you got? You talked
creative, they work totally digitally. Oh, they did it with pencil and paper. Which is awesome. I mean, they did digital ink and paint, because I come from working on paper and the flippy thing and the peg holes, and like that's where I, you know, I caught the tail end of that, which was fun. Learned digital stuff as I needed to, but yeah, they do Harmony production pipeline, but they get our animatics timed out. They get the X sheet with the voices broken down, and they get all of the, you know, the material for props and designs. But yeah, they're animating with pencils, scanning and digital ink and paint. Yeah. Anything else?
Did you produce all the animatics in-house?
Yep.
So you would send that overseas and animate and get back?
Pretty much. There was still, like, once the storyboard part was done, my crew went home. I had to review the animation. And you start to see, like, that's where I sort of noticed, like, if you weren't exact, they're not going to embellish. So if it wasn't clear, I'd be like, oh, that's got to move like that. But yeah, that's what they would work from. We would do them all here. Am I answering your question? I got distracted by thinking about it. Oh, there was no directing from a distance. The animatics had to be solid. Like that was the map. And then we had a certain amount of time for revisions, a certain amount of budget for revisions, technical revisions, and creative revisions. If it was like that layer's on the wrong place, that's free. If it's like, we want him to do this instead of this, that costs money. So you'd have to sort of balance that. Yeah.
How nice were the drawings in the animatics?
Were they super nice?
No, would you consider them
Drawings? Yes. That's what ask Carlos, he was a board artist, he'll tell you.
We didn't actually sort of see any of those, right?
From the pilot, yeah, which
so they were that good.
That was like I didn't color them like that because right. That was asinine.
They're sort of that quality. So that's what you gotta do to
it's almost keyframe animation. Yeah,
yeah,
definitely. Yeah, no, it has to be, yeah, that's the thing. And even when we thought we were doing it right, when I got the animation back, I'd be like, really, you guys, did you miss that?
So how much work you were doing on it for the first two?
Yeah.
Very different.
We figured it out in the end, but like we had to do a lot of, like, because we had a director. We sort of evolved the process, sort of made it our own. We had, I was supervising director, so I could oversee everybody. We had two separate directors who would thumbnail out based on the script and the animatic, broad strokes, that would review notes. Then we tend to the lead board artist who would flesh that out, still keeping it kind of rough, but start to flesh out the acting, taking care of the notes that were coming in, really embellishing and making it come to life. And then we had teams of revisionists on that would take it even further and tighten the drawings, make sure it was on model, make sure all the props were right. Because, like, again, we're getting character and prop designs in as we're trying to finish the board, so everything's like racing towards this funnel. You're talking about like the contract where like we're gonna pay you to, because they basically bought the copyright, right? Okay. They own these characters now they have a standard contract for buying intellectual property for a show. Every step that we had from the option deal to the pilot, they had its own separate contract. When we got to series, you get that first contract and no one ever takes the first contract. I learned that the hard way. Shadi from Running Puny, I have to say, she's really good at that kind of work as far as she's done that enough running a business. But it is sort of, you can negotiate in a couple things where if Amazon's this is one and done, the rights come back. If I wanted to, yeah. Like I own Philip, so Philip will come back to me. Merchandising, we got a small percentage if they start selling toys. We didn't get signed for like guaranteed 3 seasons. We're like, you're doing 26 and then we'll talk. So there's wiggle room. There's a kind of a set price that you can sort of adjust. And like, that's, you know, having Snowbait, we are able to say like, oh, we can take this much off, so we can hire this many more board artists or this many more designers, and you just like shift pennies around until it all makes sense. So there's a lot of upfront time before like the meat of it starts. Yeah. There was, for the series or for the, for a show, there is a story editor. Sometimes there's a writer's room, sometimes there's just writers that work freelance. All the writers were out in LA, so Amazon had people they like to work with. We had people that we wanted to try to work with. But they get, we would have sort of these, and Eric, the voice of Philip, was a writer. He wrote a lot of episodes as well, which was great, because he understood the character better than anybody. We'd have premises, we'd share those with Amazon, we'd pick a certain amount, we'd hire have these writers ready to go, you're going to get this script, you're going to get that script, and the story editor would sort of keep it together, keep it on track, keep it on point for the show, stylistically, what have you, page count number, all that kind of stuff, I was less involved with writing day-to-day, but that's sort of the broad strokes. Does that answer the question? You had a question. So what? You?
What was your fight with Chicken Butt?
Oh, thank you for asking. They were iffy about the Chicken Butt. Amazon had a thing like they didn't want fart jokes. They didn't want poop humor. They have a line, but so did I. My line was like, I'll bend and weave on anything else, but the Chicken Butt, you're just gonna have to trust me that that is funny. Like that, like it's funny, right? It's like that, to not do that. Like they're like, maybe he just lives underneath, and like because it's like she's you know, just like waiting for him to hatch. Like no, he's not even progressed that far in life. And like starting your day every day squeezing out of the back of a chicken, and then it's just funny. So they were like, we don't know, we don't like this gross stuff, and we we're all, one of the things we were all unified on the production side was like, we'll change anything else but the chicken butt, and they're like, fine. And it was good. There is a question. Do you still have a question? Or was it about the chicken butt? Oh, so that answered for you? Yes. Of course, there are many things I would have done differently. I would have been more forceful about my character and about my thing, but I stepped into this thing like, I'm going to see what collaboration is like. And it's a, you know, it's a battle of egos and people's jobs, and it's a lot of stuff. And so I feel like I could have had a tighter hold on things. I mean, I do, it's 50% mine. I'm an executive producer, all this kind of stuff. So it's awesome, and I still think Philip came through from 2003 to now. But I would be, I would say, fuck you more often. I'm doing it my way. But that's hard to do in those negotiations, to be honest. Because, you know, Amazon's putting up a lot of money and a lot of trust in this, like, risk, because all their stuff before then was existing property, like a book or a comic book or something. So I was really willing to see what it was about. What I would do differently, I think I would have probably developed Philip more. The question before about, do you keep something secret or do you make a thing? I would have like made my own little shorts of Philip until someone picked it up. I really think that if you know what that character is, you know what something, and it feels right to you, you should just make it, because you have the tools now to make it. Rather than, because this is such a long shot. I mean, it's awesome, and obviously it can happen, and it's even rarer that it happened here, but if you're banking on that, it's hard. You know, you gotta make a living, and you gotta feed your cats, and you gotta stuff like that. So, I don't know. There's plenty of things, contract negotiations, I would think differently, but you know, I got a lawyer, and I got, you know, there's all sorts of things I haven't had before, and, I learned patience, and I learned, you know, how to trust my artists, and how to take the notes as they come, push back when you think it's necessary, like play the game for the most part. I'd definitely be better at it next time. I'd probably still sweat a lot and not sleep, but it's fine. it's not fine. Anybody else? Question? Oh.
What's a good Amazon note?
Which Sheriff Luke one?
I don't know.
Yeah. John's one of our board people. God, do you have one in mind, Hegel?
I was thinking seatbelts.
Okay, good, because that's what I was going to go with. Okay, so, notes from network. So Dee Dee, crazy, jumping around. I'm going to go in this abandoned, rusted out water slide that's going to probably kill me and like all these terrible things. The one big note that we got at the beginning is when she's riding that scooter, she had to have a seatbelt and a helmet on. because S&P, Standards and Practices, saw that and had a hemorrhage. And I was like, but she's climbing like rickety stairs and like has like a boat anchor in her pocket. And they're like, and it was this fine line between what a kid can imitate in real life, and if you make it just bizarre enough, maybe it'll get by. And we had a hell of a time trying to predict that. And I think we got to the point where we just like, just do it. They'll tell us if it's not right or not. We got, okay, seatbelt, fine. Like that was always like the note, like everyone gets seatbelt, like we all were on the same page. We'd catch it when other people would, because you just don't think of that stuff. But, you know, that was lawyers stepping in and people worrying about, you know, some kid driving on those scooters and cracking their head and suing Amazon and whatever. But, you know, it's part of it's part of what it is, part of the machine. John. Oh, yeah, there is, I wish I had some images of it. It's what was affectionately called the orca mouth. There was, Because it was, you know, it was so much fun. Let me tell you this. When I started with the board team, and I told this story before, but I'm in my office. I hear everyone laughing out, like individually people are laughing about stuff. And I don't, like, is there a joke I'm not in on? What, are you guys making fun of me? What's going on? And it turns, they're just laughing at drawing Philip and Dee Dee. Like, they're drawing, you know, and, like, that's awesome. Like, that's golden right there. But there is this, this thing, I don't know who started it, but his mouth was just the whole egg. He's screaming at this one point, because, like, yeah, someone's good. Yeah, and it was hilarious. Like, and when we kept doing it, and we kept getting this note back, they'd be like, I don't know about that orca mouth. And we'd be like, maybe. And then we'd leave it in there, and then be like, we have to get rid of the orca mouth. And so, like, you'd have, fine. Like, you got, but, like, that's the things, like, these inventive things that were happening with Philip's face and as a character from these other artists. But, you know, we pushed as far as we could sometimes. The weird sexual tension between Rhonda and Philip. It's so great having you guys here. This helps me. Some of my team is here. There's an episode. I'm going to show an episode, not the Rhonda episode. How much time do we have? Does that mean I have to stop talking? 11 minutes. Oh, what time are we done? Oh, sweet. All right. So Rhonda and Philip, there's an episode called Broccoli where Philip, no one really knows how old Philip is. And then they're eating lunch, and Philip discovers that he loves broccoli, and Dee Dee's like, only grown-ups like broccoli. You might be a grown-up. So it became Philip had to move out of the chicken, out of Becky. He had to get his own place. He had to get a job. So we had, somehow we had a cartoon episode for a kid's show about real estate. So Rhonda, the real estate agent, is showing Philip the houses, and there's something going on, man, between the two of them. It was really in the performance of the character. Like, that subtlety was there, like, whether it was intended or not. So, like, we just thought it was funny, and we just played with it. It was one of those things, like, let's see how far we can push it. So she, you know, she would cozy up to him, and she would, you know, do one of these things on his chest, and like, and just like how far. And then at one point, she's showing him this greatest house. It's like this safety non-slip floor. It's like Philip's dream house. And he walks in, and she's laying on the table like, what's the movie? The Graduate. She's got, and the camera's looking through her leg. And Amazon was like, no. So our solution was, okay, fine. She's laying like this. I'm gonna do it again. But she's going like this, and we just moved the camera and shot through her arm, so it was the same framing, but it was through her arm. And then we got it back where there's an episode with a security guard reading a romance novel, and on the cover is Rhonda and Philip, and Philip's got flowing hair. And so it never really went away. Thanks, guys. That's great. I forgot about all that stuff. Anything else that I forgot about? Dee Dee's eyebrows? Dee Dee had what, the floatingness? Yeah, the floating eyebrows, yes. And the floating eyebrows and tiny face, those are all you, Joe. sometimes they would just be too high, and they'd be like, where are Dee Dee's eyebrows? Why are they flying away? It's like, it's funny, it's an expression. It's like a rule that they don't attach her because she's so excited they pop right off of her face. Or Philip doesn't do that. They called that out. For some reason, they zeroed in on that one. And then the tiny face thing, which we won, I think, for the most part, wouldn't you say? Joe says, maybe. Could have gone, but, like, there's a certain expressions where, like, Philip's got all this space, but, like, if something really hits him, if the emotion's right and the timing's right, if his face gets, like, this big, it is so funny. And it's, again, one of those things that was explored, you know, that I didn't even think of doing, but, you know, these board artists would do. And they would question on it, and I think we won a couple of those, not enough. We had one where Philip was upside down, and his face stayed right side up. We won that one. We knew, because we laughed really hard at it, and they were just looking at it in this sort of, in this, like, I'm a network making notes sort of way, and we're just like, come on, try it, it's funny. And they said, fine. So, you know, you can push back and wear people down, but, you know, schedules are schedules. Yes?
Sorry.
It's fine. I can try. It was close to $500,000 for a season. I don't know what it was per episode, to be honest. But it was a good budget. Yeah. 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 We shaved off enough of that so that I can have a bigger team and. I'm probably wrong, now that you're saying it that way with the math. How many minutes for each episode? 11 minutes, two per show, so two separate stories. You know what? I don't know. I'll just say that. It was enough to hire good, so much money went to the actors we hired. I mean, we got Weird Al on the show, so you know that cost a certain amount of money. I know I'm right about the $300,000-$400,000 so of being taken off a snow bait, because we got like 25% back or something. So 20, whatever that is, figure that out. 25% was $300,000-$400,000, then times four. There you go. Thank you. So I don't know. Again, I've never done this before, so I don't know what budgets are normally like. I'm told they're decent. It was a decent budget. I feel like. The rate for doing storyboards in St. Paul was pretty good, right, guys? Like, it was pretty good. Oh, come on. Well, trust me, it was pretty good. It was, you know, paid our rents. Yes. 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 What's weirder about it is like you have no idea if it's going to work. Because like normally, like a network show, they'll do like six episodes, put them out there while they're finishing the other ones. So you start to getting a gauge for the sense of how people are responding to it. Like this was all or nothing. So it's kind of a big risk. And it is weird because like it's not like everyone's excited. It's like, it's Thursday, let's watch the show. It's like, no, it's like you hope they, and like that you hope they find it. And Amazon, you know, Prime is, you know, not as, like I ran into a lot of people say, it's on Amazon Prime, I'm like, what's that? Versus like Netflix, everyone knows what that is. Like there's people that didn't know, it's a little harder to get to, you know, whatever it might be. So there's a certain amount of, it's out there, good luck, everybody.
At the end of the day, it's like, I have a show, so it doesn't matter.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it is a little bit because there's definitely something to that. I mean, that's why we had the premiere party for the pilot, because there's my whole career, I'll say one of the greatest rewards is watching your thing with an audience. And hopefully they respond well to it. Because if they don't, it's the worst thing in the world. But to like for people to like respond and laugh to a thing that was in your head. Yeah, it's there's nothing better than that, if it succeeds, if it's good. If not, it's your fault. Anything else? Anyone else? Yes? Wait. They said it's doing pretty good. No, really, like, that's, yeah, no, it's, They'll make their decision, but we don't like see the numbers exactly because you know they have other factors they have to come in here and see how well it does. But again, I have no future planned right now. This is it. You're looking at it. Yes. On a very special episode of Danger. I don't think so. I don't know. It would take it to a whole other place, but that's the thing, you know, he's afraid of really becoming who he really is, which is a chicken, also, ultimately, right?
That has a double meaning.
Doesn't it? So it's, I like the tension of not knowing. Yeah. Well, we just get different pants. But you're not, see, this is the thing I love about Philip. People like, oh, what a funny character, he's so weird, I feel like that sometimes. No one says, why does he have legs and what are they made out of? It's like, he has legs to pick stuff, to walk, and arms to pick stuff up. That's as far as I thought about it. And that's great, actually, because people care about who he is more than what he is. What else? You almost had another one. I don't know if I know the exact number on that, but we were like consistently 4.5 stars. Like that's, I'm more than numbers, like I know shapes and pretty things. I would personally be more involved in writing if possible. I would really like to get the same team back for my part of it, guys. Only because, like, really, like, they know the show now. They made the show. They created the. You don't really have a show until you make a season one, is what I've been told. No one knows it better than this team that's made it here and in LA. They've, you know, but people have to again move around and find jobs differently. I'd bring Philip's cello back. I am so upset that his cello only showed up once, and it was in that case on his back when he was leaving. But to me, Philip playing the cello, like there has to be a moment of that, like I want a long music episode. It's like, to me, like there's so many beautiful things can happen in that moment. And again, that's one of those things where I was saying, like, I didn't speak up enough and fight enough for things like that. I fought for the chicken butt, not for the cello. So pick your battles, I guess. Yes. Probably finishing out the peak episodes, because like doing the color correct. I mean, there was the color correcting, the final editing, the music. Most of that was happening in LA. I was at working from home, doing my animation notes from home, spotting the music. Didn't have to sort of do as much management. It was task oriented. But no, definitely, like, you know, you're like 20 episodes in and like it's a marathon, man, like, and everyone is giving so much to it and fighting the good fight for it and trying to, you know, be on top of their game. So like you're like, we just got 5 more to do, you guys, and that's like how many weeks, right? So definitely yeah, right around episode like 19 is when the drinking started. Yes, it was. I barely drew after a certain point. I was like notes manager and facilitator. I had help with all that stuff, of course. But it was just like, that's why, like, having 2 separate directors and me as supervising director, my job was to float around. So I'd be looking at directors' thumbnails for their new episode and going to the pitch with them on that. I jump over to revisionist to see if things, you know, on model, or they were like wondering if this pose was working and showing me a scene that they've been fixing and working on. Then I jump over to the editing station and see how that animatic was going. And then I'd look at designs there. So yeah, my job was to float. Yeah. In the back. It happened on the pilot with the monster, the snake rat king thing, because it's a very, you saw that drawing, like when we showed them that drawing, they were like, we're not doing that. And so I came up with like a basic layering system of like, here's the shape, here's the layer of squiggly things, and these will just be eyeballs or whatever. And like, that's the best I could do for them, but they made that thing sing, like it was amazing. Like I did the best I could, like, here's one way you could approach it, and they took it and ran with it, and it turned out really good. Like, that's where they really went the extra mile for us on that, because it was sort of, it was the monster, it was the boss fight, it was the thing at the end, so yeah. Hey, should I go to the show watching the episode now? Yeah? All right. Let's do that. Thank you, everybody. I hope I put it on here, by the way. Shit, did I? I put it in the thing. God damn it. Oh, sorry, mic's still on. Can I do that? That's true. That's true. I like the way you think. Is he coming? I wanted to show an episode, and I didn't provide the QuickTime for it. Is it go? We can do that? All right. Everybody close your eyes. Don't look at my password. Do I need to do it? I'm already on here. I'll just do this. There it is. I feel like I should watch the Rhonda episode after that. All right, we're going to do it. So the pilot's on here. I don't have time for two episodes, right? It's kind of a long time. All right, thank you. All right, so I'm going to play this episode, but I'm going to go past the pilot just so we can watch Broccoli. Yeah. So now that you know the deep dark, because it still came, it's still there. It's still there.
With me, because I can make wishes come true. Follow me.
You can do it with magic or without.
Wishing poof. Look, what shapes do you see? Yum!
Yes, it's a fact that fried rice tastes the best when multiplied. By fried.
When you say shrimp, I say pea.
Shrimp?
Pea!
Carrot!
Corn!
Broccoli.
Ugh! Yeah! Get pigeons, destroy the fool's tree, little teeny nasty boys. Philip! Green alert! It fell into your mouth! This is not a test! This is broccoli!
Not so fast, Didi. I suspect. Yes, I know. I like it!
Gasp! Everyone knows the only people who like broccoli are grown-ups!
Lydia, cancel lunch. I found lunch.
Are you sure you liked it? Double lie detector positive you liked it?
It was crunchy. It was floridy. It was delicious.
Oh, this is bad. Quick, Philip, how old are you?
Well, let's see.
Wait a minute, you don't just know?
Height, 2 eggs tall. First haircut, none. Birthplace, mom. It appears my records are incomplete. I might be a grown-up!
The Brock never lies.
Well, comparing insurance rates sounds fun. Wait! This is all happening too fast.
Philip, I know you're not ready, but you gotta figure this grown-up thing out by, right now, or you'll end up stuck in limbo.
The popular cruise ship stick dance. How low can you go? Go low! The stick will get us!
No, Philip. The limbo I'm talking about is a spooky, shadowy place in between being a kid and being a grown-up. You've never heard the legend of limbo? Failing at being a grown-up makes limboids appear out of nowhere, stumbling towards you with their slithery, grabby limboid arms.
I know it's you, Didi, I think. But this is freaking me out.
First, The limboids grab you, then they mark you with the letter L. From then on, you're sentenced to an eternity of wandering the earth hopelessly. Not as a kid, not as a grown-up, but as a limboid!
If I become a limboid, does that mean I won't be able to enjoy snacks? Does that mean that I won't be able to giggle in the sunshine?
Not just that. You won't be able to do grown-up stuff either, like file taxes, or constantly check the weather report, or put on topical creams.
No taxes? I've been looking forward to filing taxes my whole life. Dee Dee, look at my hand.
Philip, we only have one choice for you to be a grown-up, and I'm gonna help. But first, we need advice from the best grown-up there is.
That gentleman?
Lydia! Broccoli! Nom nom nom!
No. Drink up, because Philip and I need some serious advice. It's a matter of life or limbo.
Not the game with that obstacle stick.
Father, do you remember when you became a grown-up? Aw, Dad, that's so nice. He became a grown-up when he had me. Philip, you need some responsibility, like big time. And Dad thinks being a grown-up means taking care of someone else. Well, I mean, he tries. Here, take care of this!
I have become a parent. You, adorable little one, your name is Greg, with three G's. I can't wait to teach you about earthquake preparedness.
See, you're natural. Now that you got a kid, you gotta get your own house and a job.
Oh, a house with secret passages. For secrets.
No, focus on grown-up stuff. Like making a grocery list or sorting your laundry. Or else, limboid. Philip, you can do it. Remember, you're a grown-up now. You need to be on your own.
Mom, I need to talk to you about something. Mom, please. It's just, there comes a time in every egg's life when he has to move out of his mom, no matter how cozy, warm, and roomy she is. It's just the grown-up thing to do. Look it, I have a Greg of my own now, and he has to be everything to me. We'll visit when our schedule allows.
Now this is a perfect starter home. Ugh, can't you feel it? Lots of light hardwood floors and hardly any spiders.
Spiders? Rhonda, may I call you Rhonda?
Well, you already have.
When it comes to spiders, I prefer none. And on top of my no spider policy, I am seeking a place that feels more like me.
Feeling like you is what I do, Philip. That's why I'm the number two real estate agent of Chicago.
Who's number one?
Doesn't matter. Oh, it speaks for itself, or does it not? It speaks. We listen. Oh, yeah. Now, what it's saying is don't worry about the snakes.
Rhonda!
It's speaking. Okay, now it's not speaking.
Rhonda, I don't believe we're on the same page about what I'm looking for, me and you.
Don't lock me out, Philip. Invite me into your world. Close your eyes. What do you see?
I see an oasis of safety. A serene getaway with all the latest precautions. Anchor-proof glass, a cold heat stove, and a fire escape to escape from fire.
You heard him, number two. Go find my friend his dream house.
Oh, let me feel. Oh, you, me, same wavelength. Oh, is this it? Is this it? It is! Or it isn't. Or isn't it, this?
I've only seen that excited face once before, the day Liquid Bandage came out.
So he likes it.
Liquid Bandage.
Dee Dee! Look, look! Did you see that?
Anti-slip floors! That's one of your 10 favorite kinds of floors!
No corner tables!
We call those round tables.
Greg, look! You can be as wild as you want.
I knew this would be the perfect match. The previous owners invented pool helmets.
Pool helmets? Those are on my list of top five favorite helmets.
Oh yeah, right between bike and baby head shaping helmets.
Did you happen to see the hypoallergenic grass? Huh?
I'll take this house.
How much?
Okay.
No way a house could cost that much. How gullible do you think we are?
Well, you are a kid. And an egg.
Dee Dee, we must buy this house. I need a job. Don't tell other people about this house!
Oh, no! It's the Limboids!
I'm failing at grown-upping. They're here. Over there.
Come on! Don't worry, Philip. Nobody who works here knows what they're doing. You're great at helping people.
I must be successful and dominate the food service industry. You watch Greg.
Dee Dee.
Stay away from the salad bar. There's no sneeze guard. Good afternoon, patrons. Welcome. May I start with suggestively selling an appetizer?
Aw, check out your dad working.
Presenting the 12-plate carry harness. Do not use with soup. Soup requires a delicate touch. Sneezer!
Greg, look away.
You're fired.
Well, okay. If that's how you'd like to treat a salad bar hero, I must go. I'll never afford my dream home.
It's the Limboids! Run!
This is the opposite of fair. I failed at securing a home and job, but I still have Greg. I care. I am a competent parent.
Don't worry, Philip. I'm not gonna let them catch you. I'll run with you forever if I have to. China, the North Pole of China.
No, Dee Dee! I won't let you give up your childhood. It's me they want. I surrender. I'm not ready to be a whole grown-up. Take me to limbo.
I can't let you go alone.
Wait!
Take me too, you Limboids!
Limboids, you say? You got wacky mouth.
But your jackets, the letter L.
Fantastic, isn't it? We're the Love to Hug Club. I'm a founding hugger.
Then why were you chasing my friend?
It's group hug day! You look stressed. We thought you could really use one. Come on.
I did not see that coming.
So you're not going to take me to a shadowy void where I will wander forever between two worlds?
That's the chess club.
Just to be crystal clear, you do not care if I'm a grown-up or a kid?
Or whether or not we like broccoli? We're not putting a label on this?
Let me answer that with a hug pile!
Hug.
Of trying fried rice. Something new.
You tried something new. You were willing to broccoli sacrifice being a kid for me. Thank you.
So tell me, if you're not a grown-up, are you gonna go with being a kid?
You know, Dee Dee, I'm not sure, and I'm choosing not to care.
Don't you want to know what you are?
I'm a curious expert with changing taste.
Great. You do you.
Here's the best thing that came out of this.
Oh, maybe it's time you gave that egg a lesson in personal hygiene, stink burger.
Don't listen to Aunt Dee Dee. She's just jealous.
Not jealous, just nauseous. Ugh!
This is all made up of blow
drums. Well, look at you!
Alright, there you go. Or I gotta sign out so no one buys anything on here. I did, I was having lunch with a squirrel. There's another episode where I'm running with a handful of snakes and screaming. So, all right, that's all. Thanks, everybody.